OSHA requires employers to record and report on-the-job fatalities, injuries, and illnesses. For answers about who, what, how, and when to record and report work-related fatalities, injuries, and illnesses, we look to OSHA's 29 CFR Part 1904. First, it's important to note that recording or reporting does not mean establishing who was at fault, that an OSHA rule has been violated, or if the employee is eligible for workman's compensation. This aspect of OSHA regulations is simply about recording any incidents, injuries, or illnesses. Second, there are some partial exemptions to Part 1904. Employers are not required to keep OSHA injury and illness records if they employ 10 or fewer employees at all times during the previous calendar year, or are in the retail, transportation, or service industries, or any other industry listed in Part 1904, Subpart B, Appendix A. However, any employer may be required to keep injury and illness records if they are specifically requested to do so by OSHA or the Bureau of Labor Statistics, or if there is a local statute requiring record keeping. This means that, in addition to understanding federal laws, employers are required to stay up to date with any state or local requirements for incident or illness record keeping. In addition, if an employer has companies in more than one industry, the partial exemption applies only to the company or companies that are in the exempted industries. It is not a blanket exemption applying to all companies owned by that employer. Finally, all employers, regardless of industry, are required to report any work-related fatality, inpatient hospitalization, amputation, or loss of an eye to OSHA. Now that we understand who's responsible for recording, let's move on to discussing what OSHA requires in terms of records. So, for OSHA-compliant records, you must record injury or illness cases that are work-related, new, or specifically mentioned in Parts 1904.8 through 1904.11. Now we'll explore these requirements in greater detail. First, how do you know if an illness or injury is work-related? An injury or illness is work-related when it has been caused by something that happens at work, or when the work environment has significantly aggravated a pre-existing condition. For example, the following injuries would be considered work-related. An employee sprains a wrist while attempting to lift a heavy object as part of their day-to-day work. An employee had previously sprained their wrist and attempted to perform their job before they had completely recovered, further weakening the arm, requiring medical treatment. Or, the employee sprains their wrist by falling in an airport during business travel. And just as it's essential to know examples of what is work-related, it's important also to understand some scenarios that would not be considered work-related injuries, which may include when the employee is at the workplace as a member of the general public, if the symptoms are entirely due to non-work-related causes, like an employer-sponsored bowling tournament or jogging club, for example, if the employee is engaged in personal tasks outside of normal working hours, if the injury occurs during a motor vehicle accident in the parking lot, if there is the common cold or flu, or, in most cases, if the incident stems from mental illness. So, if an employee is injured during the annual Family Day softball game, or while shopping at their place of employment after their work shift has ended, or requires treatment for a diabetic episode, none of these incidents are work-related. How do you know if an illness or injury is a new case? An illness or injury is a new case if the employee has not experienced a recorded illness or injury of the same type that affects the same part of the body, or if the employee had completely recovered from the previously recorded illness or injury and has relapsed due to a work-related cause. Here are some basic guidelines. If the symptoms reoccur without exposure, this is most likely a chronic illness and not a new case. In this case, you'd simply update the previously recorded entry. If the employee had not completely recovered and symptoms worsen, this is not a new case. It is a continuation of the previous injury. And finally, how do you know if the injury or illness meets the general criteria or one of the specific cases? An illness or injury is recordable if it results in one or more of the following: death, days away from work, restricted work activity, transfer to another job, medical treatment beyond first aid, loss of consciousness, or significant injury or illness diagnosed by a licensed healthcare provider. Restricted work is when an employee is unable to perform one or more of their routine job functions for a full workday. The exceptions to this rule include minor musculoskeletal discomfort, If a licensed healthcare provider determines the employee is fully able to perform all of his or her routine job functions, or if the work restriction is assigned to prevent a more serious condition from developing. Most serious injuries and illnesses will require medical treatment or days away from work. However, there are a few injuries and illnesses that don't fit this mold. For example, a punctured eardrum or a broken toe may not require medical treatment nor work restrictions. Or some progressive diseases like silicosis may require no restrictions at the time of diagnosis, but could at a later date. If a licensed healthcare provider diagnoses a significant injury or illness that falls into this category, OSHA requires recording at the time of the initial diagnosis, even if no medical treatment or restrictions are recommended at that time. OSHA also lists some special cases. Always record needle stick and sharp injuries, medical removal, hearing loss, and tuberculosis. In summary, if an illness or injury is work-related, a new case, and meets OSHA's general criteria, it must be recorded. By recording and reporting fatalities, injuries, and illnesses in accordance with OSHA regulations, you are helping make workplaces safer for everyone.